You're listening to WNJC 1360 AM in Washington Township, New Jersey, and on the web at WNJC1360.com. We're Forsyth Broadcasting Company. Stay tuned, Repatriot Radio is coming right at you.
Baer and Dan Haggerty here. Welcome to the show. Today we're going to be discussing the book Subversion, Inc.
Matthew Vadum here.
Okay, Matt. Very good. Oh. We have the author on the line. This is Billy Baer and Dan Haggerty, as I just said. Welcome to the show.
Hey, how are you?
I'm great. We were just talking about your book, Subversion, Inc., how Obama's ACORN red shirts are still terrorizing and ripping off American taxpayers. I'm going to just do a
Indeed they are.
That is, they certainly are. You got us a little nervous there. Anyway, I'm going to just do a quick introduction, and then
okay.
Dan's going to set it up, and then we'll get right into it.
Okay.
Matthew Vadum is a senior editor at Capital Research Center, a think tank that studies radical left advocacy groups and their funders. Subversion, Inc. is a culmination of nearly 3 years of research and hundreds of interviews. Since 2006, his work has been cited in more than 24 books and by multiple media outlets, including Fox News, The Weekly Standard, The Wall Street Journal, and USA Today. Matthew Vadum has a master's degree in American Studies from Georgetown University. Welcome again, Mr. Vadum.
Hey, thanks again for having me on.
Hey, Matthew, how are you? This is Dan Haggerty.
Hey, how are you doing, Dan?
Good, good. Very interesting book. I just finished it, and I'll tell you two things about it. It made me very upset to read it, I have to say that.
I'm actually glad.
Yeah.
I hope it stirs you to do something.
It did the job. Well, we feel we're doing things anyway, but I sat down to read the book last week, and as I said, it was just made me very agitated to read it. It's literally upsetting, but I finished the book, and if anything, I have a much greater understanding of the menace we face and the difficulty we're looking at. So that was quite an eye-opening event for me. I'm going to read something from your introduction that, to me, is kind of the thesis of the book, I think.
Okay.
In your words, it was out of the nihilistic 1960s that the small-c Communist Association of Community Organizations for Reform Now was born. ACORN poses as a civil rights group, but is nothing of the sort. It is a group committed to tearing down America in order to transform it into something unrecognizable. The story of ACORN is the story of the planned decline of the United States that is now in progress. It is the story of revolutionary Marxists Richard Cloward, Francis Fox Piven, and Saul Alinsky, who developed disruptive antisocial strategies and tactics aimed at destroying the American system from within. To me, that's the thesis of the book. Would you agree?
Sure. Yeah, it's about their efforts to basically to overturn the American Revolution and to turn us into France, or to give a more current example, Greece, a place where they don't have the same kind of economic freedoms and political freedoms that we have here.
Okay, sticks out in the book. When you read further on in the book, you encounter the theories of Cloward and Piven, which we can get into later, but the program that they instilled, or the force that they expected to use, is something they described as the weight of the poor, W-E-I-G-H-T, the weight of the poor.
Right.
In other words, yeah, they were going to use the poor and manipulate them into taking so much revenue from the government that it would collapse.
Using the weight of the poor as a battering ram,
yeah,
against American society.
Right, yeah.
Against American, yep.
Right, in what ways, can you just give some examples of how that's being carried out?
Well, it was originally, it was intended as they wanted to pack the welfare rolls. In the mid-60s, Richard Cloward and his wife, Frances Fox Piven, two leftist university professors, discovered that only about...
University? What university?
Oh, they went. They were at different ones. There, I think at that time they were at Columbia.
Okay, Columbia, New York. Okay.
Columbia University in New York, and Cloward died in 2001. Piven is still around, and she's at CUNY, City University of New York, where she's corrupting young minds, as we speak, no doubt. The idea was that only 50% of the people in American society who were eligible for welfare were actually collecting welfare. So they theorized that they could bring about a radical transformation of society if they got the other half to get on the pogey. And so they set up an organization to recruit people onto the welfare rolls, and it was called the NWRO, National Welfare Rights Organization. And it was very successful in getting people to go on welfare. And they used brutal, sometimes violent tactics. They would go and invade welfare offices and terrify caseworkers and destroy furniture and just make their lives difficult. And that was
Matthew. What was the ultimate purpose of this, to get more people on welfare? I mean, I've read about them quite a bit, and it seems like at least superficially their purpose was to help the poor.
Well, superficially, that was the purpose, I suppose. One could argue, but the goal was to get people dependent on the government. And to create a constituency that would keep voting for politicians who want to expand the welfare state. They were creating basically an army of poor people to use tactics against government in order to make it uncomfortable for bureaucrats and caseworkers and politicians so that they would give in to their demands. And their immediate demand in the 60s was for a guaranteed annual income scheme, kind of like what you have in European welfare states right now. And they came very close to succeeding. President Nixon bought into the idea for a time and only backed out of it at the last minute. But he had been committed to it for a while. The welfare recruiting that the national...
When you say welfare, can you just expand on when you say welfare, I'm understanding you mean more than just what people typically view as the typical, you know, welfare check. I mean, it would be more just government systems in general, or welfare as we know it in particular, or is it the...
The standard welfare would be like AFDC, aid to families with dependent children, mm-hmm. and food stamps and so on. Anything like that where it's a gratuity from the government, where it's not something that you earn. So, for example, Social Security wouldn't be a welfare program because people, you've paid into it. Unemployment insurance wouldn't even necessarily be a welfare program. I'm talking about a pure welfare programs. And so these welfare rights organizations and National Welfare Rights Organization was the biggie, but they started a movement, the welfare rights movement, and they also would demand, like, if people were allowed clothing allowances or furniture allowances, they would show up at welfare offices and demand that everybody get that all the welfare recipients in fact receive everything that they were entitled to get. And often they would seek to get things that they weren't entitled to get. And one of their organizers, a young man at the time, Wade Rathke, who went on to found ACORN in 1970, was an organizer for NWRO in Springfield, Massachusetts. And he got a bunch of welfare recipients together, about 200 or more people, and he led a march on the local welfare office to demand, I think it was clothing, the clothing allowance that people were supposedly entitled to in winter. The local person in charge of the welfare office ruled that the people were not eligible for it, that Rathke's group was mistaken, and several days of rioting ensued in Springfield, Mass., and millions of dollars in damage were caused, and it was written up in Pravda at that time. During the Cold War, it was used as enemy propaganda, to show how horrible and violent and out of control America was. And Wade Rathke, the founder of ACORN, led that violent attack on a welfare office. And so then they continued that when ACORN got going.
So that kind of set the tone of the tactics. It really set the tactics for ACORN from then on, because they would just seek out any leverage they could get in any of these welfare offices and any of these charitable organizations. You know, it's interesting in your book. You know, I'd heard about Alinsky and I'd read about the rules, but there's some things about Alinsky's background that were just really kind of shocking. I didn't know there was a connection to Al Capone and the mob in Chicago. You have an anecdote in the story that's it's just really sobering. Frank Nitti, if everyone would remember, was Al Capone's enforcer and Al Capone's murderer, basically. And Alinsky is actually in your book discussing with Frank Nitti. He says to Frank Nitti, why did you hire an out-of-state murderer when we've got plenty of hitmen here in Chicago? And Alinsky explains Nitti explains why to Alinsky, and Alinsky writes that it was a real lesson in sociology that he learned in 5 minutes from Frank Nitti. It's just amazing.
So that reinforces what you're saying, Dan, about the tactics they used, and essentially it ties into what you're saying in your book, Matthew, about the whole idea of ends and means, how with ACORN and their offshoot organizations, the ends always are justified by the means.
Including violence.
Or the means, I should say, are always justified by the ends.
I mean, Matthew...
That's right. Violence is part of it. Not with every action ACORN right. undertakes, because each little campaign is called an action in community organizer parlance. But often, violence is part of the mix.
Well, I think you pretty much show in your book that they would prefer not to use violence, but if violence was necessary, philosophically, it's not a problem for any of them. I mean, you make a connection in the book from Al Capone to Frank Nitti to Saul Alinsky to Bill Ayers to Barack Obama. I mean, in one sense, they're all members of the same Chicago mob.
In a way, they are, separated by the generations, but they are definitely united in spirit and purpose.
It's just unbelievable. I mean, I thought I knew a lot about that situation, but I really didn't. That kind of proves this connection kind of explains why Barack Obama spent so much effort trying to distance himself from Bill Ayers, you know.
Well, of course, and he ultimately it wasn't successful, except in the eyes of the mainstream media. But everybody else who has an ounce of sense can see clearly the connection there. And as I note in the book, Bill Ayers and Barack Obama served on a couple of charitable boards together, the Chicago Annenberg Challenge and the Woods Fund of Chicago. And while they were there as board members, they voted to give money in the form of grants to ACORN. It just makes perfect sense that Bill Ayers would support ACORN. At other times, at some point, I've referred to ACORN as the Weather Underground's little brother. And some people have said, oh, well, that's hyperbole, you're exaggerating. Well, not really, because ACORN is the far less violent counterpart of the Weather Underground. They believe in roughly the same things. It's just their tactics are different.
Now, Matthew, just to get a little broader picture here, let me tell you what my perception, I believe that many people have a similar perception of ACORN. grassroots storefront kind of organization made up primarily of racial and ethnic minorities, which operate and control it, kind of unsophisticated and operating at a rather low level but with broad appeal. Is that accurate?
That's what ACORN does?
Yeah. I mean, I think that that's the public perception to a large extent. I know it's my perception in the past.
Right. Well, there are some things where the state chapters and local chapters would branch out on their own, but they did take orders from the head office, definitely, and all the money was funneled through the accounting arm of ACORN, CCI, Citizens Consulting, Inc., which has never been properly investigated. Money would just disappear into it. It was like a black hole or a vortex, and that would handle all the paychecks for ACORN. It would accept all the grant monies, and then it would redistribute it through to the various corners of the ACORN empire of activism. And we don't know where a lot of the money's gone.
Would you say it's somewhat analogous maybe to, you know, like you see a small, you know, car dealership perhaps in a small town, and behind that is Ford Motor Company or Toyota or something like that? Is it that type of analogy, would you say? Because the perception is that it's kind of a local, you know, small local concern that's helping the poor.
I don't think that's,
I think that's been the perception.
Yeah, that's been the perception.
Well, people have viewed it as a grassroots undertaking. And to an extent, that's true. But you know, in another sense, it isn't true. Because ACORN was a top-down type of organization. It was run, even though many of its members were black, there are almost no African Americans in leadership roles in ACORN. The most prominent was Bertha Lewis, who was the terminal chief organizer from 2008 after Wade Rathke was fired by ACORN's national board for covering up his brother's $1 million embezzlement from the organization. And ACORN sent out they coordinated activities, and Wade Rathke was the chief organizer of ACORN from the time he founded it in 1970 till 2008. And it was highly centralized, and it was controlled by means of what are called interlocking directorates. So you had a lot of the same people would be on the board of one of the ACORN affiliates, such as ACORN Housing or the American Institute for Social Justice or Project Vote or what have you, and they'd all be on the same boards together. So it's easy to see how the influence of the headquarters would be exerted on all the individual parts of ACORN. And there are more, at least 370 affiliates that I identified.
One of the things that just was really astounding is in the end of the book, which is very well detailed. You have a lot of information there, but in your appendix, you have 370 ACORN organizations or ACORN affiliated organizations. So the conclusion you have to draw at the end of your book is that ACORN is not dead.
No, it's definitely not dead. Like, technically, ACORN Incorporated, the lead entity, now based in Brooklyn, is all but dead. It's in bankruptcy court. Bankruptcy proceedings often take years to wrap up. So, but ACORN is, to all intents and purposes, dead as that legal entity is, but its tentacles are still out there operating. The various state chapters have incorporated themselves separately under assumed names, and they're still doing business. Like, for example, you're in Philly and Jersey, right? That's your coverage area.
Right.
I don't think they've done anything in Jersey yet, but in Pennsylvania, the ACORN split itself up. ACORN Pennsylvania split itself up into two different organizations, Pennsylvania Neighborhoods for Social Justice and Pennsylvania Communities Organizing for Change, which goes by the amusing acronym PCOC. these groups were both active in the Joe Sestak campaign. It was ultimately unsuccessful against Pat Toomey. So when Pat Toomey would go debate Sestak, they would stand outside with signs, anti-Toomey signs, and protest Toomey's position, policy positions. And, you know, they're quite active. This Pennsylvania Communities Organizing for Change, for some reason, adopted another business name, Action United. And as Action United, a few weeks ago, they went and disrupted a board meeting of Aetna Insurance in Philly. So they're still very active.
Yes.
And is there any reason to think that they're less active than when they were not so-called broken up?
Well, they had more money under the previous under the previous circumstances. So no, they're not doing as much as they used to, but they're trying to. They're trying to get back in the game and reestablish the funding links and try to be active.
Explain to us how the funding works. Who's paying for them? Who's paid for them in the past? Is this through small donations from local people in the community or other?
We are. We're paying for it.
Well, yeah. As taxpayers, we've been paying for ACORN to an extent, a certain percentage, percent of their budget. Overall, not a very large percentage, but the point is tax dollars shouldn't be going to such a radical organization that is clearly not nonpartisan, as it claims to be. You know that ACORN, the Obama administration, just slipped a grant under the radar to ACORN Housing back in March. I wrote about it on at biggovernment.com, and the group that discovered it, Judicial Watch, has a piece up at biggovernment.com right now. Tom Fitton of Judicial Watch wrote about that about 3 hours ago. And the Obama administration gave $80,000 to ACORN Housing. ACORN Housing isn't even a new entity. All they did was they changed their name to Affordable Housing Centers of America. So Obama is already helping ACORN, and he probably broke the law because a law, a statute, a funding, spending bill was enacted that said that no money out of the fiscal 2010 appropriations of Congress could go to any ACORN affiliates. But voila, ACORN just got 80 grand of your money.
So you're accusing the President of the United States of breaking the law?
Shocking, isn't it? Shocking.
Unfortunately, it's all too commonplace now.
That's about the fourth ground. I've been keeping track, that's about ground number four for impeachment.
The way we've been keeping track, it's about ground number 40.
You've been paying closer attention than I have.
Well, Matthew, that's very interesting. Let's pursue that for a second. What are your other three grounds, in your opinion?
Well, I don't really have an opinion on the Defense of Marriage Act, whether it's a good idea or not, but it is the law of the land, and the president's supposed to enforce it. And he said that when it comes up to the appellate court level, the Justice Department is not going to defend the law, and that's the custom, is that the federal government, there's a presumption that laws are constitutional, but he's just said, I don't care, and we're not going to defend it. So
okay.
that's an example. The military, the kinetic action that's not a war in Libya?
Yes, exceeding his authority.
Right, especially after he made such a big deal out of President Bush's, wars. This is a man who said the War Powers Act is vital and it's important and it's absolutely needed. And now that he's in charge, you know, it's what War Powers Act? What are you talking about?
Yeah, exactly. He's above and beyond it. That's very interesting. Well, from our perspective, we have recently done a number of shows with other authors who have written books about these issues, and Jack Cashel, among others, who determined that Obama didn't write his book, that Bill Ayers wrote his book. We've had Carl Denninger on, And I think your book kind of encompasses a lot of these issues. For our audience, for our listeners, again, we are speaking with Matthew Vadum, the author of Subversion Incorporated, How Obama's ACORN Red Shirts Are Still Terrorizing and Ripping Off American Taxpayers. The book is published by WorldNet Daily. I read it last weekend. It was a real eye-opener. I can recommend it to our audience. Billy, you had a question you wanted to ask about additional impeachment?
Not really right now. What I'd like to talk, just go back a little bit to some of the tactics that we were developing before. Specifically, what I'm interested, because it seems like it's the most obvious tactic, and it has such widespread use, is the tactic of ridiculing your opponent or your enemy. Can you just get into that a little bit, of how ACORN uses that tactic and how it flows from Alinsky? And it's being used by this administration with great success.
Well, it's pretty simple. The idea is that you must polarize, you must demonize, you have to vilify your enemy, because it is easier to motivate your people to do something, to do what you want, if there is a really clear-cut villain figure. The left is really good at this. You've noticed recently they've discovered the Koch brothers, who fund through the Koch Foundation, charitable foundation. They fund a lot of conservative and libertarian advocacy groups and think tanks and so on. But they've, you know, they're characterized them as these evil, you know, blood sucking billionaires who want to take away everything from the poor and don't believe in democracy and blah blah blah, all this crap. It helps them to rally the troops to have an enemy who's a person, somebody they can actually relate to. And that's, you know, a large part of what it is. And this is what the left does nowadays routinely. ACORN, when it would protest corporations that it was trying to shake down, and or if it was trying to get the corporation to change its policies, to hire ACORN members, to lend money to people who couldn't afford to pay it back, to buy housing that they shouldn't have been buying in the first place, they'll bring a big inflatable rat to a rally. Attack whoever owns the organization personally. They'd go to the person's house and take a busload of angry activists and dump garbage on their lawn and, you know, tear up the place and frighten and intimidate their family. They just view it as strategically useful to have a whipping boy, a scapegoat.
Well, and in fact, President,
and that's what the left accuses the right of all the time.
Sure.
But the right is nowhere near as sophisticated in scapegoating as the left is.
That's because typically the right, I think, has more values that they're bound by, which kind of ties into some of the other Alinsky points.
Well, Obama himself has used these tactics, which is kind of a new low point for presidential campaigns. You remember the comment about Pennsylvania residents, you know, Bible and gun clinging.
That's right. You're all toothless redneck hillbillies,
right?
According to the president in Pennsylvania.
And clinging
to your guns and religion.
Right, gun clingers. And he recently spoke to a group of Hispanic activists and described Republicans as the enemy.
Why would
you want to support your enemy? I mean, these are things that haven't been done in American politics, and I think that's one of the points of your book, is that, you know, we're witnessing a real sea change in American politics, and it's very detrimental.
Obama's not a uniter, he's a divider. He wants to drive a wedge between groups. He wants to play them off against each other. He wants to cause as many problems as he possibly can so that the frightened populace will run to him and demand that there be more government in order to take care of the problem that, in many cases, the government created in the first place.
Now, that goes right back to one of the elements of your book. It's a description of the Cloward and Piven crisis instigation.
Right. Some call it the Cloward-Piven strategy of orchestrated crisis. Others have other names for it. And yeah, absolutely, it's about causing problems. And it's initially started as packing the welfare rolls, and then there's another element to it as well. Cloward and Piven decided it would be a great idea to go out and register people who are on welfare to vote. And that strikes me, like, obviously if you're on welfare, you still have a right to vote. But it strikes me as a profoundly antisocial thing to go and ask people who are dependent on the largesse of the American people and then encourage them to go vote to get more money from the American people.
It almost sounds analogous to Congress voting themselves raises.
Well, kind of. Kind of. But this is, like, you can't fall, it's hard to argue against voter drives as such, but when you're specifically trying to recruit people who are burdens on the system, the approach is revolutionary. It's not to help the people. It's to encourage instability. It's to encourage people to make government even bigger than it is right now. It's not a good thing.
To break the bank. The effort is to break the bank.
Right, right. And they created, Cloward and Piven created an organization since disbanded called Human Serve. And I don't remember what the acronym stands for, but Human Serve was all about getting people who are on welfare to vote. And that, you know, it can't be good getting all these people who are on the pogey to head to the ballot box.
Absolutely, absolutely. Now, that's one of the main issues that we have, and most people have with ACORN, is that not only have they instigated a lot of people to vote for the wrong things and in the wrong manners, but they've committed a lot of vote fraud. You list a number of cases, many more than I had thought were occurring, but you list a number of cases, particularly Nevada. The Secretary of State has been pursuing ACORN for voter fraud, and there have been a number of prison sentences meted out in this area. Do you want to talk about that for a minute?
Sure, sure. Well, just most recently, in April, in Las Vegas, Nevada, ACORN itself was convicted in a massive voter registration fraud, a massive conspiracy, and sentencing is set for August 10th. ACORN pleaded guilty.
Okay.
ACORN itself. This happened after the book already went to press. I think in the book I just said the charges were pending.
Yeah, I'm looking at it right now. It said at the time of writing, multiple counts remain pending against ACORN in Nevada.
Right.
So that's right.
So ACORN, this is the first time ACORN as an organization has been convicted.
I might be wrong, but isn't Harry Reid from Nevada?
Ah, what a coincidence. The other thing is, they also, ACORN reached a settlement in a racketeering lawsuit in Ohio and agreed to leave Ohio about a year ago. A conservative think tank called the Buckeye Institute brought a lawsuit under Ohio's anti-racketeering laws. And that's not quite a conviction, but it still counts in terms of helping to show that this is a habitual pattern of conduct for ACORN,
right,
and that ACORN should be charged under racketeering statutes.
All right, let's Matthew, if we can, let's talk about what I think is the most egregious example of vote fraud in the book, and it's one that has already cost this country a lot, and that's the election of Senator Al Franken.
Yeah, there are a lot of questions about Senator Al Franken's election. Wasn't it amazing how the Republican was ahead the whole time until time started to pass, and suddenly all these Democratic votes started magically appearing. Oh, the zero was in the wrong place, and we really meant to put 100 there and not a zero. And then you could actually see them on the internet. One of the newspapers in Minnesota was posting all of the was posting many of the ballots, contested ballots, on the Internet, and you could see where it was marked for the incumbent Republican Norm Coleman, or at least it looked like it was, and yet they would count it as a vote for Al Franken. And that happened hundreds and hundreds of times. Now, whether ACORN was involved in stuffing ballot boxes, I don't have any proof that that happened. But it is telling that the person in charge was a longtime ACORN ally. Person in charge, Norm Ritchie.
Yeah.
Mark Ritchie, you're right.
Ritchie, yeah.
Mark Ritchie himself was a community organizer with a group that dealt with food issues, agricultural issues, before he became Secretary of State of Minnesota, and he worked very closely with ACORN. There are all sorts of pictures on the Internet of him at ACORN meetings and so on, and, you know, talking to ACORN people.
Well, aside from him being in that position, just on the face of it, statistically, as you describe in the book, it said, Trent Lott noticed a few days after the election that almost all of Franken's new votes came from only three out of the state's 4,130 precincts, and nearly half of the new 246 Franken votes came from one heavily Democratic precinct in Two Harbors. It's just, it's a statistical anomaly that is just too much to accept, that out of 4,000 districts, you know, an average number of incorrect votes didn't appear, but they appeared out of just three districts. That just doesn't make sense.
No, it doesn't. And it was Professor John Lott who found that. He's an economist, I think. And he just said it couldn't happen. It's just not possible.
Yeah.
That there could have been so many deviations there. He just doesn't believe it could have happened.
You sound like a conspiracy theorist to me.
Well, the thing is, you know, Democrats, they just like to keep voting until they win.
Yeah. Well,
if they're losing, then it must have been ballot fraud by the Republicans.
Yeah. Oh, exactly.
So they reason.
Some conspiracies are true. That's the problem. You know, the thing that's so important about that is that when you had the Senate almost evenly divided, the election of one senator has enormous importance.
Well, it did. It helped give them the 60 that they needed to ram Obamacare through.
Yeah.
To overcome a filibuster.
And as many of us have read, and you mentioned in your book, there's that old aphorism, I think, said by Joseph Stalin, it's not how many votes that count, it's who counts the votes.
Yeah, that's absolutely true.
And Cynical, but true. And I understand that ACORN and George Soros and other affiliated groups have long had a program to install, secretaries of state who are amenable to the goals of ACORN.
Right, secretary of states who don't believe in the American democratic system and that want to help Democrats use and abuse it for their own ends. And it's called the Secretary of State Project, and George Soros has given money to it, and it backed Mark Ritchie in Minnesota, and it has a pretty strong track record for electing Democrats who don't believe, you know, who want to bend over backwards to let people vote who don't have ID, who buy into all these myths that Republicans are evil vote suppressors, and they want to, you know, stop Americans from lawfully casting their ballots. So there's an interesting little anecdote. The person who helped investigate ACORN in Nevada was a Democrat, Secretary of State Ross Miller. He was endorsed and he won with the help of the Secretary of State Project that we've been talking about. When he was up for re-election this time, they didn't back him. And I'm speculating, but I think it's a pretty good speculation, educated guess, that one of the reasons they didn't back him this time is because he actually investigated ACORN. He put party aside and decided it was the right thing to do, even though they were allies of the Democratic Party. And there are a few good Democrats out there who have taken action against ACORN.
Well, you know, one thing I noticed...
The Pittsburgh DA, Zappala, is it Robert okay. Zappala, has laid lots of charges against ACORN employees, and he's a Democrat.
One thing I notice in your book is that you have maybe a half a dozen or more former ACORN people who became whistleblowers, and I guess out of conscience or what have you, they testified against ACORN and have given you a lot of information as to what the real tactics of ACORN were.
That's right. That? Well, the one who testified in court, it was actually in a Pennsylvania lawsuit, was Anita Moncrief, who testified around the time of the 2008 election about the maxed out donors scandal and what happened. She used to work for ACORN and Project Vote. The two organizations have almost always been indistinguishable. Same people, same offices, you know, they're the same organization. And she said under oath that the Obama campaign had a whole bunch of donors who had already contributed the legal maximum, and that they gave the information, they gave these leads to ACORN and Project Vote so that ACORN could get, squeeze them for some more money, knowing that ACORN only helps Democrats. It was only going to help Obama in the 08 election. And she testified under oath about that, and the Eric Holder's Justice Department hasn't done anything about it. They don't care.
Yes, and I recall now. I know Anita Moncrief. I met her at CPAC, this recent CPAC in February of this year. She has a new organization where she's fighting to get the truth out, and she's quite a gal. And you mentioned other people who are former ACORN.
Right. There's a woman named, a very intelligent, nice lady, named Marcel Reed, who lives around in the greater D.C. area, and she was on ACORN's national board, and after the $1 million embezzlement was discovered in the summer of 2008, she tried to lead a real, honest-to-goodness investigation, and she was frustrated at every turn. Bertha Lewis, who took over from Wade Rathke after Rathke was fired by the board that Marcel Reed sat on, refused all requests for financial documentation and stonewalled her and didn't allow her to do her job that the board had appointed her to do. So... And eventually they forced her out. It was like a Stalinist purge. They just said, you're not welcome here anymore. You're just causing trouble. When all she wanted to do was to see the paperwork related to the embezzlement.
Yeah,
and that embezzlement, by the way, involved ACORN pension funds, workers' money.
Yes.
And still, Eric Holder's done nothing about it.
Absolutely.
I thought Eric Holder and Obama cared about workers. I guess not.
It depends on who the workers were. You
right.
Describe it, you describe in your book that there's 20-something members of the board of ACORN, and quite a few of them were actually very repelled by the fact that Wade Rathke's brother had embezzled the $948,000, and they tried to cover it up. That's when Rathke
right. The senior leadership of the organization did cover it up, and Bertha Lewis was complicit in that after the fact. I don't think she was in at the beginning, because the embezzlement actually happened around 1999-2000.
Right.
So it was covered up for 8 years, and they kept Dale Rathke, the embezzler, on as an employee at ACORN the whole time, amazingly enough. Normally, when you catch somebody stealing, you fire them, at a minimum, don't you think?
Well, unless nepotism is involved, and that's what you had here.
Promoted. Right.
Now, some of these people formed a whistleblower group called the ACORN 8.
Right, that's Marcel Reed and Karen Inman of Minnesota. Karen has a background as a lawyer. She has a law degree, but I don't think she ever practiced. But she's a very smart, capable lady. Just like Marcel.
Okay.
Now, Matthew, let's try to
work out for us the nexus between ACORN and Barack Obama in terms of his past connections and also his present connections.
And what can we expect in the upcoming election? That's what I'm concerned about.
Yeah, I think the upcoming election is going to be very nasty and scary, unfortunately, but that's just the lay of the land right now. To go back to Barack Obama's beginnings with ACORN, Obama led a very successful get-out-the-vote drive that helped elect the really radical left-winger Carol Moseley Braun to the U.S. Senate from Illinois in 1992. And that made Obama a star of sorts in the community organizing world, and gave him a lot of street cred, and he was praised and regarded as a, you know, an up and comer, a mover and shaker. And Project Vote is who we worked for. Project Vote is, as I said, part of ACORN, and it remains active nowadays. Project Vote is still operating, by the way. They didn't even change their name. They operate right here out of ACORN's Washington, D.C. headquarters down on 8th Street Southeast, across from the U.S. Marine Barracks, interestingly enough. So, that's right. And Francis Fox Piven is on their board of directors, is on Project Vote's board of directors right now. And she's been involved with ACORN well, the whole time it's existed, basically.
What other relationships can you establish between Barack Obama and ACORN?
Well, he trained ACORN activists. He lectured ACORN on community organizing in Saul Alinsky-inspired techniques. He represented ACORN in a couple of lawsuits in court. He just was very close to them.
Time frame did this cover? Is that his relationship with ACORN?
From 1992 to now.
1992 to now, yeah. So almost 20 years. There were a couple of lawsuits. One was a housing discrimination case, and the other one was the Edgar case, which was a Voting Rights Act. A governor was refusing to honor certain provisions of the federal voting rights law. So Obama was on a team of lawyers who took him to court and won. So he gave a speech at an ACORN meeting in either 07 or 08, where he said, and it took a long time for video to turn up of it, but eventually Glenn Beck got his hands on it and showed it on his TV show a few months ago, where President Obama was talking to ACORN members and saying, you know, I've been proud to be part of ACORN's work in the past, and ACORN has been smack dab right in the middle of many good things. And he's on record as saying that. There's all sorts of pictures of him with ACORN members. Like, the relationship is pretty close, and he's worked with ACORN for a very long time.
All right. Now, he's doing nothing to conceal his connection to them. And like many other things, he's flouting it in the face of the
voters. Well, he did during the campaign. He argued, he made all sorts of arguments. His campaign tried to distance itself from ACORN. They argued, they made the really legalistic argument that Project Vote wasn't technically a part of ACORN in 1992, that it only grew close to ACORN after that. And to which I answer in the book, well, then why did ACORN take out a trademark in the name of Project Vote a year and a half after Obama worked for it? Clearly, you know, the two organizations were close, whether they were legally tied together or not. And, you know, what does it mean to be affiliated? If I say we're affiliated, we're not. We are. If I say we're not, then we're not.
Yeah.
Affiliation is a pretty flexible concept.
Yeah. So
it's clear these people are all on the same side.
Yeah. Now, listen, in the last 10 minutes, Matthew, I'd like to ask you, other than purchasing your book, which I recommend to all of our listeners, Subversion Incorporated is the name of the book by Matthew Vadum. And Matthew, of course, is speaking with us on the phone right now. A good start would be to buy your book, but what would you recommend law-abiding citizens, political activists, Tea Party people? What can we do in this situation other than talking to our congressman, which doesn't seem to work, things like that? What would you suggest?
Well, talking to your congressman is actually a good idea, because with any luck, with any luck, Obama won't be in the White House as of January 20th, 2013, so then Congress might be in a position to actually do something about ACORN.
I was hoping that that Obama would be leaving the White House a lot sooner than that.
That would be nice, but I wouldn't count on that.
Right, escorted by some FBI agents.
Frog marched? Yeah. That would be funny, wouldn't it?
For none other than for a variety of reasons, but the most recent, most dramatic reason, of course, is that this birth certificate that he's issued is a clear fraud. I mean, it's so many experts have come up to say that it's a fraud, and no one's doing anything about it.
Including, most remarkably, which probably isn't remarkable, the Republicans. Nothing. John Boehner, nothing. No investigations.
What do you say to that?
I don't know. That's Jerome Corsi's thing. I don't really know that much about it. I don't know. I'm not a document expert. The thing that they put out looks real, but I don't really know. I know that Obama has been covering up a lot about his past, and I think that people are right to be suspicious of him. You can't take anything this guy says at face value. You just can't.
I look at
the purported birth certificate, and I just scratch my head. I really don't know what to think.
What do you think about we touched on this about voter fraud? How widespread would you think, based on the past, that voter fraud on the part of ACORN could be this time around in 2012?
Well, I'm sure that it will be quite prevalent. You know, there's other groups that commit voter fraud as well. The NAACP Voter Fund is notorious.
Voter Fraud Fund.
Yeah, I guess they should call it that, the Voter Fraud Fund. And, you know, various abortion groups do voter registration and have trouble with the authorities when they do it. You know, voter registration drives are actually a terrible idea. You know, why should you have to go on a campaign and peddle voter registration cards like Girl Scout cookies? I don't really understand why it's allowed.
With every registration.
Well, yeah, that's right. And the more cookies you buy, the more votes you get, right?
Well,
so,
talk about that for a minute, because Matthew, in your book, you do mention one thing that I knew, but you don't hear about it a lot. The founding fathers did not want a true democracy, a complete democracy.
A total democracy is a terrifying thing.
Yeah, exactly. They feared direct. You say in your book here, and I agree with this quote. It's on page 39. James Madison and the delegates to the 1787 convention feared direct democracy because they knew it would encourage the majority to oppress the minority. And we were set up as a republic, not a democracy. So explain why you think the voter registration drives are antithetical to proper running of our government.
Well, they're antithetical to democracy in the American sense of the term, which refers to indirect democracy. Pure democracy, basically just means mob rule. Pure democracy is what you saw in Wisconsin recently, where an angry mob of leftists and SEIU people surrounded the state legislature and tried to prevent it from functioning, and tried to intimidate lawmakers as they were going inside to vote. And remember what they chanted when they were outside, having taken over the place by force. They chanted, "This is what democracy looks like."
Right, democracy is the last step before anarchy.
Well, democracy you know, total pure democracy is a frightening thing. It just means mob rule.
As Alex Jones described it, it's two wolves and a sheep sitting down to decide what's for dinner.
That's right. Absolutely. So then you just go with the passions of the crowd, and that, you know, if one day someone's fallen out of favor, then everybody, you know, has a mass meeting, and then they decide to take the guy's property away.
Well, when you think
that's
about
democratic, but it's not fair.
Right. When you think about that, you understand that the pitfalls in that system, but you also realize that this capital D democracy that is touted in our press and in our universities and in our educational system is the reason that the truth of that has been obscured. I mean, we hear newspaper editorialists and talking heads on TV talking about the wonder of our democracy and how wonderful it is, but when you describe what you just did, you realize that that's not the system we want. That's not the system that the founders wanted.
No, we want America is a constitutional republic, and in order to get things done, you have to follow certain processes. And it's not just, you know, whatever the mob wants immediately. It was set up that way to prevent mob rule, to prevent pure democracy from taking hold.
Now, you've described also in the book the New York Times, how they reliably spike stories. For example, reporter Stephanie Strom did some fine investigative articles on ACORN.
She did.
ACORN.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and they spiked her story.
Well, she had the maxed out donors story that Anita right. Moncrief testified about in that Pennsylvania courtroom. And she was ready to go run with it, and the editor said, no, we don't want to run this. It could... you know, affect the outcome. It could be a game changer. Whether or not it would have been, we'll never know. I kind of doubt that it would have been a game changer, but considering the cult of Obama had already taken hold, but it is something that the public needed to know.
Well, in and of itself, it might not have been a game changer, but let me tell you about the other story that was spiked, and that's the story by Jack Cashel.
Mm-hmm.
Bill Ayers writing, the Bill Ayers the terrorist, really being the author of Obama's book and the fact that Obama lied about his association with Bill Ayer. So enough of these little stories that in and of themselves might not have been game changers. In the aggregate, yes, they could have been game changers. So one of the points you make in the book is that the media is very complicit in pulling the wool over the public's eyes on ACORN and a lot of other issues. Do you want to close out by talking about that?
Well, yeah, because the ACORN, the media regards ACORN as noble, angelic crusaders for social justice. So when ACORN uses force to take over a branch of a bank and have a sit-in there and harass the employees, they don't consider that news. That's just democracy at work. That's just poor people trying to get some justice. And they don't treat it as if it's a big deal. And so when these groups engage in flagrant law-breaking and criminal trespassing and destruction of property and intimidating corporate executives and sometimes even government officials, they don't even think it's worth reporting about. It's like, eh. You know, on to the next story. We don't care about this because it's normal and it's what ought to happen in their view.
Okay, yet another.
It strikes them as right. It's the right thing to do. So what? You know, what's a big deal? That's not news in their view.
Right. Well, Matthew, we're just about out of time. With us this past hour is Matthew Vadum, author of Subversion, Inc., How Obama's ACORN Red Shirts Are Still Terrorizing and Ripping Off American Taxpayers. Thank you so much for being with us, and we'll do this again.
Yeah, happy to come on.
Very good. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. That's Jillian Dan out for this week. We'll see you next week. Bye-bye.